morning, everybody. I'm Cello Tonelli from the University of Calgary. This is Adir Levin from Vancouver. I'm delighted to welcome to you to this special session, Late Breaking Clinical Trials. I'd like to declare the session open.
And I wanted to give a bit of context. This is the, we thought we would do something different at the International Society of Nephrology and not only present to you late-breaking clinical trials, but do it in a manner that actually allows you to truly understand the rationale, background, and the nuances of a clinical trial. So this session, instead of being short vignettes, is actually three major late-breaking clinical trials with enough time for you to truly appreciate, and therefore a number of speakers. We hope that you appreciate this kind of a venue and opportunity to have a more in-depth assessment and understanding of very important clinical trials. As you know, we've had a paucity of trials in nephrology that actually change clinical practice, and it's important that we as a community understand more fully the value of clinical trials, how they can be designed and executed in a way that's inclusive and gives us important information to go forward. So with that, I'll ask Cello to introduce the first speaker and also appreciate that because of the amount of depth of time that we're giving to each one, that there will be no time for questions.
Thanks, Adira. So before we get into the detailed analyses of the two clinical trials that Dr. Levin mentioned, we will start with a free communication from Dr. Brendan Smith. Dr. Smith is a PhD candidate through the School of Public Health at University of Sydney, and he's a practicing nephrologist at Miranda, New South Wales. Dr. Smith will be presenting the free communication entitled Long-Term Follow-Up of a Randomized Controlled Trial of Extended Hours Dialysis. Dr. Smith.
So, good morning, everybody. So, today I'll be presenting the long-term follow-up data from the active dialysis trial of extended hours dialysis. Here are my disclosures. So, despite decades of experience, we all know that patients receiving hemodialysis still have high rates of morbidity and mortality. Moreover, their quality of life remains poor. And here in Australia, for example, survival at 5 years is only 50%. However, patients doing extended hours dialysis, whether that's more frequent or longer sessions, tend to do much better. We present here a range of studies across a number of contexts with survival rates over 80% at 5 years in some cohorts. Further, the durability of extended hours dialysis is reasonable, with some evidence that patients starting on extended hours dialysis are likely to continue with it, with over two-thirds still doing that technique at 5 years. However, there's little in the way of randomized data. Only two studies have reported long-term outcomes after periods of intervention. The two FHN studies randomized participants for 12 months and then followed their outcomes for a further 4 years. On your left, we can see the FHN daily study, which randomized participants to short, frequent sessions and found a 46% reduction in mortality over the full 5 year follow-up period. However, in the FHN nocturnal study, in which participants did frequent, longer overnight sessions, there was an unexpected increase in mortality. So currently there's considerable uncertainty about the true benefits or risks of more intensive dialysis, which brings us to the active study. So active dialysis recruited 200 participants from 40 sites in 4 countries. The intervention period lasted 12 months, and participants were randomized to do at least 24 hours per week in the extended arm, or in the standard arm, 12 to 15 hours per week with a maximum of 18. Most participants were doing 3 sessions per week, and the primary outcome was health utility as measured by EuroQol 5 dimensions. The main results of the study have been previously presented. During the 12-month intervention period, the median time on dialysis in the extended arm was 24 hours, In the standard arm, it was 12 hours. However, we did not see a difference in health utility as measured by EQ5D, but there were a number of other potentially important benefits in the form of reduced need for antihypertensive medications, lower potassium, lower phosphate, and some small but significant improvements in other aspects of quality of life. So at the end of the randomized period, participants were free to vary their dialysis schedule. We then followed them up at 2, 3, and 5 years, at each point ascertaining their dialysis schedule, their vital status, the dates of transplantation, loss to follow-up, etc. Now, the primary outcome for this analysis was all-cause mortality, with the secondary outcome being the durability of the intervention, and we also analysed by a number of pre-specified subgroups. Survival was analysed by Cox proportional hazards regression, with censoring only at loss to follow-up or at 5 years. We performed a number of sensitivity analyses, and we'll present weekly hours both categorically, and we also compared medians using the standard tests. At baseline, the mean age of the active participants was 52, or just over 50 years. 30% were female, and the primary causes of renal disease and common comorbidities were shared equally between the groups. 62% of participants came from China, with the remainder coming from Australia, New Zealand, and Canada. The median time on dialysis at enrolment was 2.5 years, and 75% of participants were doing their dialysis in centre. So over the full 5 year follow-up period, we observed a total of 877 patient years. And of the 200 participants who were randomised, 126 were still doing dialysis at the 5 year mark. Among the remainder, we observed 38 deaths, 30 transplants, and 6 were lost to follow-up, with that being balanced between the two groups. So this is the survival curve for the standard arm. And you can see that the 5 year survival in this group was quite good, with 80% being alive at the end of study. And it was not different in the extended arm. The hazard ratio for mortality was 0.91, and there was no evidence of a difference between the groups. We also looked at pre-specified subgroups, and it did not seem to matter whether you had been on dialysis for less than 6 months or more than 6 months, whether you were dialysing at home or in centre in China, as opposed to Australia, Canada, and New Zealand, the effect seemed the same. Similarly, our sensitivity analyses did not change our conclusions. The results were essentially the same, regardless of whether we censored at transplantation, adjusted for confounding variables, or treated total weekly hours as a continuous variable that could change with time. So we'll turn now to the durability of the intervention, and I'll start by presenting the standard arm during the first 12 months of the study. So the bars below the line represent the number of participants doing less than 18 hours per week. The bars above the line are the number of participants doing 18 or more hours. And we can see that that remained steady over the long-term follow-up period. Now, as expected, participants in the extended arm did more dialysis during the main study phase, with the median weekly hours being 24. However, that difference was lost by 2 years, and the two groups remained similar thereafter. At the very end of the study, among participants still on hemodialysis, 16% were dialysing for 18 hours or more, which included 5% doing 24 hours or more, with the respective figures in the standard arm being 8% and 0%. So the strengths of this study was that we had a multinational and multi-ethnic cohort, we had pre-specified observational follow-up, and our loss of participants was minimal. However, the sample size was small, and persistence with extended hours after the randomized period was low. The generalizability of this patient population to the broader patient population, that is, broader dialysis population, may be restricted, but our survival at 5 years was similar to that seen in other cohorts of extended hours dialysis. So where does that actually leave us? If we look here at a meta-analysis of the long-term follow-up of the two FHN studies and the data from ACTIV that I've just presented today, we can see that there is still no evidence for a benefit from more intensive or extended hours hemodialysis. However, it's important to point out that there's significant heterogeneity between these studies, and that based on the current data, we are still unable to exclude potentially important benefits or harms. So to conclude, the ACTIV dialysis study is the largest study of extended hours dialysis to date, and 12 months of extended hours dialysis did not affect mortality over the full 5-year follow-up period. The durability of extended hours dialysis after the randomized period was low. So I'd like to thank all the participants and the study investigators and trial staff at all of these locations, and of course these individuals for their contributions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I also failed to welcome those of you that are online listening. This is the first ever live streamed late-breaking clinical trials, and people have gotten up all over the world at different times to listen to this session. So thank you, Brendan. I'd like now to introduce Dr. Dick DeZoo, who will actually introduce his colleagues in SONAR, the study of diabetic nephropathy, and atravesentan. Trial. This is a randomized double-blind placebo-controlled trial that compares the efficacy and safety of a selective endothelin antagonist with placebo in patients with type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease. Dr. DeZoo is a nephrologist and clinical pharmacologist at the University Medical Center at Groningen, where he's the past head of clinical pharmacology and the director of the Groningen University Institute for Drug Exploration. He will be presenting his talk as well as introducing his colleagues. Over to you, Dr. DeZoo.
Thank you, Adira. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, the ISN, for giving us the opportunity to bring you the results of the SONAR study, actually for the first time. As you see, it deals with atrasentan and the renal events in type 2 diabetes with chronic disease. We will present it to you with the four people from the steering committee, and we obviously do this presentation also on behalf of all the PIs and the steering committee. Don Cohen will start with the introduction to the endothelin antagonism, and it will be followed by Ida Lombers-Heerspink, who will do the study design and enrichment results, which is one of the unique facets of the SONAR study, this enrichment part. And then the primary outcome and secondary outcome will be given to you by me. And finally, Ricardo Correa-Rotter will put this into the perspective of clinical practice in the future. So, Don.
Good morning, everyone. So, endothelin is a very unusual molecule. It is very highly stable. You can see here it has two interchain disulfide bonds that make it resistant to degradation. It's extremely potent. Its activity in the renal vasculature is tenfold higher than any other known vasoactive factor. And its effects are very long-acting. So when ET1 binds to its receptor, it stays there for several hours. So the net effect of endothelin under physiologic conditions is a natriuretic effect. And I won't go through all the details here, but you can see it involves many organ systems. And the net effect is you wind up with natriuresis and diuresis from activation of endothelin receptors. Endothelin is also a pathophysiological molecule. You can see here on the left, endothelin interacts with numerous different cell types. And on the right, you can see in green where it has all of these various pathologic features. I won't read through those. In general, all of these pathologic features are mediated by the ETA receptor, whereas in blue, the ETB receptor tends to be protective. So endothelin is thought to have a significant role based on preclinical studies in chronic kidney disease. You can see where multiple factors listed here on the top stimulate renal endothelin production, which acts predominantly on the ETA receptor to stimulate vasculature, podocytes, tubules, et cetera, to exert multiple pathophysiologic effects, all resulting, at least theoretically, in CKD progression. So specifically in diabetes, you can see in this study, looking at different stages of CKD, there's progressively increased renal ET1 staining. And then in this study, where they knocked out ET receptors specifically in podocytes, you can see on the bottom part, there's a marked protection from glomerulosclerosis in mice that are missing ET receptors in the podocytes. Similarly, ET receptor knockout in podocyte protects the endothelial glycocalyx in diabetes, and you can see in the bottom that typically in diabetes there's a loss of glycocalyx, and that's prevented when you are missing podocyte ET receptors. So then we go into the clinical trials in diabetes. The first clinical trial was done with avacentan, which is a bit of an A and B combined antagonist, looking at a reduction in albumin excretion in type 2 diabetics. And what I want you to notice here is that the doses of 25 and 50 milligrams avacentan reduced proteinuria about as much as the lower doses, but were both associated with significant peripheral edema. And these were in patients with normal renal function. So then moving ahead, a trial was done with avacentan called the ASCEND trial, and you can see at 3 and 6 months, there's a significant reduction of albumin to creatinine ratio, but the trial was stopped prematurely because of excessive fluid accumulation, congestive heart failure, increased morbidity and mortality, and you'll notice this is done at the higher doses of avacentan. So knowing this, a number of years ago, we did a study with atrasentan looking at albuminuria in subjects with type 2 diabetes. Atrasentan is more ETA selective than avacentan, and different doses were used. And you can see here the different doses. It was done over an 8-week period, and you can see that there's a significant reduction in albuminuria. And that particularly if you look over on the right side, you see those with more than 40% reduction in albumin excretion was particularly evident at the 0.75 milligram dose. If you look back on the left side in blue, you'll notice where we've written edema. You can see that the degree of edema was about 18% in the 0.75 milligram and 46% in the 1.75 milligram. So this basically tells us that you can get similar reduction of albuminuria with a marked difference in fluid retention. And this is borne out in this slide, where if you look at the different doses, you can see there's no correlation between the albumin excretion and the fluid retention. So in the follow-up study, the phase 2b study, this was RADAR with 211 patients using two different doses of atrasentan over 12 weeks. On the left, you can see that both doses caused a significant reduction in albumin excretion, and both doses caused a mild decrease in arterial pressure. And importantly, you can see there's a significant difference in the weight gain with these. At the lower dose, the 0.75 milligram, there's no difference in weight at the end of the trial, but at the higher dose, there is a significant difference in weight. So in summary, endothelin via ETA receptors promotes renal injury in diabetic CKD. Endothelin receptor antagonists were protective in preclinical studies. ERAs lower albuminuria, but can cause fluid retention. ASCEND had major problems from excessive fluid retention related to drug dosing, patient selection, and lack of sufficient diuretic use. And finally, endothelin receptor antagonist dose can be adjusted to reduce albuminuria yet avoid clinically significant fluid retention in diabetic CKD. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Hitto Hirspink. Thank you.
Thank you and good morning, everyone. It's my privilege to present the SONAR study design and enrichment results. My disclosures are listed at the bottom of the slide. Ladies and gentlemen, in the last years, a number of clinical trials have been conducted to identify new therapies for patients with diabetic kidney disease. Unfortunately, none of these trials succeeded to find a new treatment. One of the trial design deficiencies was that the past trials did not take into account the high variation in individual response to different intervention strategies. To improve the likelihood of detecting a treatment effect, the design should try to maximize the potentially benefits of therapy while minimizing known adverse effects. Albuminuria and weight changes are potential markers to select patients before randomization who may benefit from an endothelin receptor antagonist with minimal side effects, an approach also called personalized medicine. Indeed, we have recently shown that early treatment effects on albuminuria correlate with long-term treatment effects on kidney endpoints, as shown in the left graph. In addition, during treatment with an endothelin receptor antagonist, early effects on body weight predict a long-term risk of congestive heart failure, as shown in the graph on the right side. So indeed, changes in albuminuria and body weight can thus be used to identify patients who may benefit and who don't develop the adverse effects, and thus tailor the right drug to the right patient. As already presented by Dr. Cohen, in a study with the selective endothelin receptor antagonist atrasentan, we demonstrated a reduction in albuminuria, but an increase in body weight. Importantly, changes in body weight and albuminuria did not correlate. So it is possible to identify patients with a reduction in albuminuria, but no increase in sodium retention, i.e. body weight. This approach of selecting patients before randomization is endorsed by regulatory authorities, such as the FDA, and is called a predictive enrichment trial. With this concept in mind, we designed the SONAR study according to the trial scheme as depicted in the slide. After a screening period, eligible patients proceeded to a run-in period to optimize RAS treatment and diuretic treatment. Patients then proceeded to an open-label treatment phase for 6 weeks and received atrasentan 0.75 mg per day. Those patients who didn't tolerate the drug, as evidenced by a weight gain of more than 3 kilograms, a brain natriuretic peptide exceeding 300 picograms per mil or heart failure, could not continue in the trial and were discontinued their treatment. Those patients who had a reduction in urinary albumin creatinine ratio of more than 30% and who tolerated the drug were then randomly assigned to continue atrasentan or to switch to placebo. This is the responder population and the population that we used to calculate the primary efficacy and safety of atrasentan. In addition, we also enrolled a population with a reduction in urinary albumin creatinine ratio less than 30%. This was a random selection and we enrolled around 1,000 patients. At the end of the trial, all patients discontinued their treatment and proceeded into a follow-up period of 45 days to assess off-drug effects. We included patients with type 2 diabetes, an eGFR between 25 and 75 mL per minute, a UACR level between 300 and 5,000 mg per gram, and a brain natriuretic peptide level less than 200 picograms per mL. We excluded patients with a diagnosis of heart failure, edema, a diagnosis of type 1 diabetes, or known non-diabetic kidney disease. In atrasentan responders, the primary population, we estimated a placebo-adjusted treatment effect of 40%, which would translate to a hazard ratio on the primary outcome of 0.73. We assumed a 6% annual renal event rate, which would give us 90% power if we would have collected 425 events. We calculated the treatment effect from a Cox regression model, which was adjusted for log-transformed UACR, serum albumin, age, and EGFR. The patient disposition is shown in this slide. We screened more than 11,000 patients, of whom 50% screen failed. More than 5,600 patients entered run-in, and 5,117 patients entered enrichment. At the end of enrichment, we identified 2,648 responders, and they were randomly assigned into the responder strata. We also enrolled 1,020 non-responders into the double-blind treatment phase. The baseline characteristics of all patients who entered enrichment are shown here. The average patient was 64 years of age, one quarter was female, systolic blood pressure was in the mid-130s, EGFR was 43 mL per minute, and the median UACR and BNP were 871 and 50. These characteristics were not different between responders and non-responders, except that the non-responders were slightly younger, had a slightly lower EGFR and a little higher UACR level. I'm now going to present you the results and the effects of atrazentan on albuminuria and on body weight that we observed during the enrichment phase. In the overall population that completed enrichment, we observed a 30% reduction in albuminuria, which was slightly less than the 35% reduction that we observed in the phase 2 study, the graph on the left side. By definition, responders showed a larger reduction, 52%, compared to the non-responders, 8%. These are the changes in albuminuria from baseline to end of enrichment, and they do not include a placebo comparison. To assess the effect of atrazentan relative to placebo, we have to look in the double-blind treatment phase. And these results are shown here. In the responders, when we compare the effect of atrazentan versus placebo during the double-blind treatment phase, we actually observed a 33% difference in albuminuria. Surprisingly, in the non-responders, when we look in the double-blind treatment phase, we observed a difference between atrazentan and placebo of 27%. So the difference between responders and non-responders in albuminuria was modest during double-blind treatment. What about body weight? In the overall population that completed enrichment, we observed approximately 0.6 kilogram body weight increase, which was slightly less than the observed body weight increase observed in the phase 2 study. There were no differences in body weight increases between responders and non-responders. Again, these are changes from baseline and do not include a placebo comparison. When we look in the double-blind treatment phase, we actually observe a very small increase in difference in body weight between atrazentan and placebo of 0.2 kilogram in responders and only 0.05 kilogram in the non-responders. During enrichment, we also collected safety and adverse event data. Serious adverse events occurred in 5.7% of the population, and 25 deaths were recorded. Adverse events of special interest included hypovolemia and fluid retention, which occurred in about 28% of patients, cardiac failure in 1.1%, anemia and vasodilation in about 5% of patients, and cardiovascular toxicity in 1.7%. That brings me to my summary and conclusions. The important question to us was whether the enrichment phase succeeded. In terms of efficacy, we had limited success in enrolling a population with more albuminuria response. In terms of safety, we succeeded in enrolling a population with minimal weight gain. How can we explain the limited success of albuminuria response enrichment? Well, this could reflect a regression to the mean, despite the fact that we used multiple measurements to characterize baseline and end of treatment UACR during enrichment. We did not include a washout between enrichment and double-blind treatment, and this could have played a role. And finally, random fluctuations in albuminuria could have mitigated our ability to detect a true response on albuminuria. And of course, this may impact the treatment effect difference between responders and non-responders on clinical outcomes. That brings me to my end of my presentation. It's now my pleasure to introduce Dr. Dezeu, who will present the primary and secondary outcomes of the SONA trial.
Thank you, Hido. These are my disclosures. As you know, these international trials nowadays are global trials, and as you see here also, that was also true for SONAR, going from Australasia to South America and North America and Europe. Not for you to, and certainly not in the back, to read this, but just to follow up on what Dr. Hirsping showed you, is that we randomized 2,648 USAR responders, and these were divided over, randomized over atrasentan and placebo, as you see in this slide. And I just want you to focus on the bottom part where we denoted that about 86% completed the study in the atrasentan arm and 85% in the placebo arm. And that vital status was known in 91% in the atrasentan arm and 89% in the placebo arm. The endpoints of the trial were a primary outcome, as is done in many of these trials, doubling of serum creatinine and end-stage renal disease, in which the definition of end-stage renal disease was an eGFR less than 15 ml per minute, confirmed at 90 days, and receiving chronic dialysis or renal transplantation or renal death. Secondary outcomes in this trial were, in hierarchical order, a time to 50% eGFR reduction, time to the cardiorenal composite endpoint, which was the renal endpoint, as I already mentioned to you, plus a cardiac combined endpoint of CV death, non-fatal myocardial infarction, and non-fatal stroke. A primary outcome in the total population, we calculated for both responders and non-responders. And the rest, by the way, that I'm showing you here is particularly for the responder arm. Again, for the time to the CV composite endpoint that I already mentioned to you was the next in the hierarchical. And other outcomes of interest that we will discuss today is hospitalization for heart failure, obviously with this trial in atrasentan where we knew the ascent results, and we will discuss shortly the eGFR slopes with you. So this is an important slide in my presentation denoting that the trial started in 2013 in August, and it ran for nearly 4 years. Well, we were discovering that the estimated 6% event rate was much lower than we anticipated actually in this trial, as you see in the blue line here, going up to around 3%. Although there was a moving up, as we know, in these trials of the events in the end part, it did lead to a decision from the sponsor to stop the trial because we had such a very low event rate, and it would take to the target number of events of 424 too long a time to continue. Obviously, it led to a debate with the sponsor and the steering committee. Nevertheless, ended in the 17 November 2017 stop of the trial. We did agree with the sponsor that the trial was ended in a proper fashion as it was in the trial protocol, and that led to a 5 to 6 months extension in that way where we could still accrue events where the events at the stop time were about around 100 events adjudicated, and at the time that we actually ended the trial, we had 185 events where we could do a power calculation and did there on that basis a full analysis, while we discovered that we had an 80% power for a 35% effect difference. The following results that I will report from the trial are only reported for the responder group. We will obviously later do much more on the non-responder group as well. So these are the baseline characteristics again that Dr. Hirsping showed you, but now divided for the atrasentan and placebo in the double-blind phase, and you see that, particularly in the bold, that duration for diabetes was very similar, that the blood pressure systolic and diastolic was very similar between the atrasentan and placebo arm, and that the eGFR of 44 was very similar, again, between atrasentan and placebo, as was the baseline level of UACR, around 800. The medications, important, obviously, showed that we are actually dealing with a group that was very much treated to guideline. There was an extremely high percentage of RAS intervention. There was a fairly good diuretic use in this population, and there was a high, about 70%, even more, statin use in the population. Now about the results, first in the surrogate markers. As you depict here on, as depicted here on the left-hand side, the change in albuminuria, what you see here is that during the enrichment, which is the part before the stippled line, it shows that there was about that 50% decrease in albuminuria that Dr. Hirschbink showed, and that when we switched into the double-blind phase where atrasentan was stopped in the placebo arm, you see that albuminuria goes up, although not to the baseline levels, which explains what Dr. Hirschbink told you, that the effect was not 50%, but the placebo-corrected effect was around 30% decrease in albuminuria. You see the same phenomenon happening on the blood pressure, a decrease in the enrichment, and then in, with stopping in the placebo arm, going more up than in the atrasentan arm. Also good to note that, and I particularly point out the scale of the brain natriuretic peptide levels, which is a scale that is very stretched in this case. Remember that we excluded those with a BNP below 300, and that below 200 is still considered to be relatively normal. And you see that there is a very low level of BNP, and that there is a continuous rise, as you would expect with CKD over time, but that there is not much difference between the placebo and the atrasentan arm in these levels of BNP, suggesting that we did a pretty good job in selecting out the safety population for this. That's also shown, again, in the body weight on the right-hand side. These are the results of the trial for the primary outcome. You see that we reached in the placebo arm 105 events, representing about 7.9%, and 79 events in the atrasentan arm, about 6% of that population, which resulted in a hazard ratio of 0.65, so 35% risk reduction with a 95% confidence interval, 0.49 to 0.88, which was not crossing unity, obviously, and which was a highly significant result of a p-value of 0.005. If you split that up into the two components of the primary endpoint, you see that the doubling of serum creatinine shows similar data, a hazard ratio of 0.61 and a p-value of 0.006, and that the end-stage renal disease had a hazard ratio of 0.73 with a p-value of 0.06, so non-significant, seeing that the confidence intervals here crossed unity. The other hierarchical secondary endpoints are shown here. So again, on the top, the primary outcome that I already showed you, and if you just focus on the right-hand column with the hazard ratio and the p-value, you see that there is a 35% reduction in the primary outcome, but in the secondary outcome, the time to 50% eGFR reduction was at 27% risk reduction with the confidence intervals not crossing unity, with a p-value of 0.038. The time to the cardiorenal composite had a 20% risk reduction with a p-value of 0.049, with the different components listed again here. And then the primary outcome in the total population, meaning this is the only result that I show you of the responders and non-responders in total, showing again a 28% risk reduction with the confidence interval not crossing unity with a p-value of 0.002. The last hierarchical secondary endpoint was the time to cardiovascular composite, was a 12% risk reduction with the confidence intervals 95% crossing unity and with a p-value that was non-significant. Important to note here that the hospitalization for heart failure accrued about 47 events in the atrasentan arm and 34 events in the placebo arm. I'm looking here at the orange bar in the graph, and that the hazard ratio for that was 1.33, crossing unity both sides, and that the p-value was non-significant. The eGFR slopes in the mixed model for atrasentan was minus 2.4 ml per minute per year, and for placebo, minus 3.1 ml per minute per year, with a p-value highly significant. Then to show you the subpopulations, here is the group, the primary outcome total group, with responders and non-responders on the left-hand side, and the non-responders separately on the right-hand side. And you see that for the responders, non-responders together, as I already showed you, the hazard ratio here, the Kaplan-Meier curves, and for the non-responders, you see that there was a 25% risk reduction with a confidence interval from 0.55 to 1.03 with a p-value of 0.079, so non-significant. These are the subgroups that we studied to see if there was any discrepancy in the primary outcome effects between the different subpopulations in our total population. And as you see, two things from this slide. One, that we are dealing with a trial that has relatively low number of events because of, obviously, that we stopped early, so that the confidence intervals are pretty high. But if you just focus on the outcome data, the hazard ratios for the different age, sex, race, region, BMI, or blood pressure, that maybe only for blood pressure there may be a tendency for a higher effect in the group that has a higher blood pressure, but that overall we see no significant p-values for interaction. And the same applies when we look at the different albuminuria baseline levels or eGFR levels, or history of diabetes, beta blocker use, diuretic use, no significant interaction p-values. Then about the adverse events, and I'm just listing the adverse event of interest and the serious adverse events to you. You see that the serious adverse events occurred in around 36.3% in atrasentan and 32.6% in placebo, with a p-value that was 0.049. And that the adverse events of interest that showed and that explained most of that difference were the ones on hypervolemia or fluid retention, cardiac failure, and anemia, as you see those three being significantly different between atrasentan and placebo, and more occurring in atrasentan. About the serious adverse events in more than 1% in either group, just to give you an impression, there is no difference between atrasentan and placebo. So in conclusion, Mr. Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, in patients with type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease who were selected for a substantial albuminuria reduction and minimal changes in sodium retention, we observed first that there was a significantly less renal effects in the atrasentan group compared to placebo, and that a numerical excess of heart failure events in the atrasentan group compared to placebo, although this did not reach statistical significance. So after this results, I would like to give Ricardo the opportunity to put this into a clinical perspective. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Dick. Thank you, Adira and Cello. In the next 6 or 7 minutes, I will try to put this a bit in context in terms of what it means for clinical practice. And here's my disclosures for you to see. And the first thing that I want to do is something that you probably have already seen and you know well, but it's really important to stress what has happened and what is happening in terms of diabetes worldwide, and how important it is at this time point that we get new therapies. Diabetes is a growing problem that we all know. It's been all over the place in this and other congresses, and we are now facing a worldwide epidemic in which by the year 2040, more than 600 million people will be diabetic, and of those who are diabetic, at least one in three will have diabetic kidney disease. So this is a major epidemic. And on the other hand, as nephrologists, we have to acknowledge that we underplay sometimes the importance and prognosis of the diabetic patient on dialysis and how bad they do. They really do bad. And this is 5-year survival of a bunch of oncologic diseases that we always look as really bad, like leukemia, like kidney cancer, like myeloma, all of which have a better 5-year survival than being a diabetic on one of the dialysis units in which many of you and many of us have patients and have worked. So that is something that we face. And on the other hand, it is clear that what we have in terms of therapeutic options are not that many. The year 2001, we saw this come. The RAS inhibition clearly is nowadays the option, the only proven therapeutic option that has advantage in preventing and retarding progression of disease. Renal and IDNT both had a reduction of 28% and 23%, as you can see in the graphs. But all that's under the last line in red is the area under the curve of opportunity, of options, of unmet needs that we need to tackle, and we need new therapeutic options for this. So renal and IDNT, it's been almost 19 years, successful trials, and from then on, a large list of trials, VA nephron, combination of ACE and ARBs, altitude, aliskiren on top of RAS, both of them failed and even showing some harm, TREAT, supposedly to prove cardiovascular protection and actually didn't show it and even showed some increase in stroke, SUN macro with saludexide, which is negative, ASCEND, that has been extensively discussed here, BEAM and BEACON, BEAM at phase 2 and BEACON at phase 3, BEAM promise, BEACON failure, and VITAL, all of them negative. And why did they fail? Well, there's many reasons, but we could claim that are these drugs of no benefit, really? Are there flawed designs and inappropriate patient selection? Or the heart outcomes were not the proper ones? Recently, we have EMPA-REG, CANVAS, and DECLARE, all on ISGLT2, but something important is that none of these trials directed primarily at renal outcome, and of course, in the next 5 or 6 minutes, CREDENCE will be presented, which is of great importance. What's happened with endothelin antagonist trials? There's quite a few. Avacentin has been described. It's a trial that was stopped because of harm. Sitaxentin is a drug that has been retired because of liver failure. Sparsentan has a phase 2 trial that was successful in reducing proteinuria and that has 2 trials right now, DUPLEX and PROTECT, on phase 3, FSGS and IgA, looking at adrenal outcomes, not only proteinuria but also renal function. And aprocitentan, precision, is one that's under study with blood pressure. So, coming back to this issue of personalized medicine and how relevant for clinical practice are the results for SONAR. If confirmed, endothelin antagonists like atrasentan could be beneficial for subpopulation of patients who are carefully selected in relation to those that present an adequate response to a good surrogate as albuminuria, as we have seen in this study, and excluding patients that either predict a bad response or who may have specific contraindications like sodium retention, like heart failure, like what was done in this study. But what is new about precision medicine? I would say nothing, absolutely nothing is new about precision medicine. Precision medicine is the way we practice, and it's the way we should practice. Given the diversity of the individual biological response, personalized or precision medicine is the thought process that any good clinician has to undertake to properly treat his patients. This drug may be good for a patient for this reason, or this may not be a good drug for a specific patient for this other reason. The potential clinical impact, just to reinforce what has been said by my colleagues, efficacy, the 35% reduction of renal events as observed in the current SONAR study would considerably reduce the risk, the residual risk in the studied diabetic population. And in terms of safety, the increased event rate for heart failure, albeit statistical non-significant, and I have to stress that, not significant statistically, needs attention and needs to be weighed against the benefits and individualized. Final conclusions. First, the class of endothelin antagonists has potential for use in clinical practice based on the preclinical data and the mechanism of action that was described. SONAR has a unique enrichment design which needs to be further fine-tuned. The effect size of the renal protective effect of atrasentan is significant and of clinical importance, and these results suggest that endothelin antagonism could play a role in preventing kidney failure in diabetic patients with kidney disease. This to show to you that we're proud to say that this trial is going to be published probably in the next half hour, will be online in Lancet, in which you will probably be able to see all the details, appendixes, and everything that you want to look into carefully. And of course, it's time to acknowledge and thank investigators, all the PIs and their teams, and patients, of course, always patients first, for their participation in the trial. AbbVie funded this study and participated in design, research analysis, data collection, interpretation, reviewing, and approval. And there was editorial assistance by Michael Tyson from Complete Publication Solutions. The members of the steering committee are here placed. I just want to stress Henrik Parving, who couldn't be here. He's co-chair with Dick Dessou, and other members like George Beckwith are here. Others are unfortunately not present, but we are thankful to all of them. Members of AbbVie team, Dennis Andres, John Brennan, Blake Hall, and all the names you see, Joel Melnick, starting November 2016, all of them have been extremely helpful. And there's been an independent SONAR data monitoring committee chaired by Peter McCullough and his team, and members of the adjudication committee that had one chairman, Rajiv Agarwal, until 2015, and a second chairman, Delaine Kisman, from then on till the end of the study with his team. We acknowledge all these people who have been in the sponsor and support team, who have contributed to the study design, planning, management, and other parts that have been of great assistance. And finally, remember that this is a very big study with close to 5,000 patients with over 600 sites and 41 nations participating, to whom we are all very grateful. Thank you very much.
I'd like to congratulate the SONAR investigators for their ingenuity and their persistence in bringing us these results today. Thank you very much to the SONAR team. We're going to change gears now and move on to our third randomized trial. This is going to be the CREDENCE study. CREDENCE is the canagliflozin and renal endpoints in diabetes with established nephropathy clinical evaluation clinical trial. As we've all heard, CREDENCE was stopped early on the basis of a planned interim data analysis which suggested efficacy. The results will be presented here for the first time. We will have presentations from five of the CREDENCE investigators over the next 50 minutes. And I'd just like to remind you that there will be no questions or discussion following any of the presentations. The first presentation will be given by Dr. George Bakris. Dr. Bakris is a nephrologist, professor of medicine, and director of the American Heart Association Comprehensive Hypertension Center at the University of Chicago. He will be presenting an 8-minute talk entitled Background of the CREDENCE Trial. Dr. Bakris.
Thank you, and welcome to all in the room and around the world. Before I start, I want to thank the ISN for allowing us to present this data, and I also, on behalf of the steering committee, want to thank all the investigators, coordinators, and most of all, participants in the trial for providing us or helping us provide information to share with you. So let me start with my disclosures. Here you go. Enjoy happy reading. And let's start off with real data. And I have to tell you, Ricardo and I, while we've known each other many years, we did not share slides here. But I do want to say that I'm going to reiterate what he said, and I'm going to add a dimension to it that he didn't. So first, let me show you where we're going. Clearly, this should not be news to you, that there's been a huge increase in the number of people going on to end-stage kidney disease, especially since the 1990s, but that trend started back in the 1980s. You're looking at the prevalence of kidney disease with the big bars and the incidence, which is also increasing in the smaller bars. Now, where are we going with this? Well, if you project out to 2030, there's going to be a doubling of renal replacement therapy around the world that's going to be needed. And this is particularly important to certain regions of the world, such as Asia and North America and Latin America. So this is not a problem going away. It's a problem that's getting worse, and we really need some inroads on it. Now, as you all know, diabetes is by far the most common cause of people requiring requiring renal replacement therapy with end-stage kidney disease. And this problem is also headed for much bigger numbers. So you can tell that this is a huge epidemic leading to major consequences. Survival of dialysis patients, you've already heard, is not very good. And in fact, this is just another depiction. This is Canadian data looking at 10-year unadjusted survival for all-cause mortality. But you can see it's been relatively flat since 1997 up to 2011. So there really has not been a huge improvement in the quality of life or survival in these patients. Moreover, if you develop diabetic kidney disease at an early age, these are data looking at the change in lifespan if you develop diabetes at age 30. And if you develop diabetes at age 30, you lose 10 years of life. But if you develop early diabetic kidney disease, then you move, depending on whether you're male or female, anywhere from 15 to 17 years of life. So this is really having major consequences at every phase of someone's life if you look at the epidemiology. Now, we've already talked about this, so I'm going to just move ahead. The RAS blockers in the 1990s and into the 2000s have been a major inroad in terms of slowing progression of kidney disease. And as Ricardo said, and I will emphasize, it has been 20 years since we've really had anything significant change the natural history of disease. We know that these drugs work by reducing intraglomerular pressure and kind of taking the load off the kidney. Dr. Brenner's work and others have clearly elucidated this from a mechanistic level. But it's important to understand that there's more that can be done, as you can see from the epidemiology. And again, Ricardo showed you some of these studies. These are some others. Basically, bottom line is a number of different mechanistic approaches has been tried to slow progression of diabetic kidney disease, and all have failed, and some have actually resulted in detrimental consequences. So clearly, it's not that we haven't tried, it's just that the results have not been very good. The SGLT2s have entered the arena, and clearly, because of their mechanism of action, which is pluripotential, if you will, there's not one mechanism of action, they reduce intraglomerular pressure, they affect atrial natriuretic peptide, they reduce albuminuria. There's some very elegant studies just published in the American Journal of Nephrology by Gabby Navarre's group at Tulane showing dramatic reduction in oxidant stress within the diabetic kidney and also dramatic blunting of the rise in angiotensinogen within the kidney. So, and there's other mechanisms dealing with antifibrotic and anti-inflammatory effects. So this is a multi-purpose drug that not only reduces glucose and blood pressure, but has many other benefits. Now, I think we need to put CREDENCE into perspective, because CREDENCE enrollment started way before EMPA-REG, CANVAS, or DECLARE were even announced in terms of results. And you can see the timeline here that CREDENCE enrollment was actually going on in 2014. EMPA-REG wasn't even announced till close to 2016. So I think it's important to keep in mind the timeline that credence was a priori thought that this class of drugs would really benefit the kidney before we even saw the cardiovascular benefits or even the renal effects in those trials. And speaking of the renal effects in those trials, there's no nephrologist in the world that would actually call the renal aspects of those trials something that they could really hang their hat on, because when you look at the results and you put it in the context of the heat map for KDIGO, you can see that they're all in the green area there, DECLARE, CANVAS, and EMPA-REG, with GFRs in the mid-70s ranging up into the 80s, and albuminuria that most people would consider would be in the normal range. So clearly, a very early, from a kidney standpoint, trial. And in fact, if you look at ESKD events or renal replacement events, amongst all three trials, so we're talking thousands of patients now, there's only 29 people requiring renal replacement therapy. So it's very hard to make a definitive statement about kidney protection just from the data that we have. Moreover, in a recent meta-analysis of all three trials, it clearly shows benefit across the spectrum of GFR stages, but there's some question when the GFR is less than 60 that maybe the benefit is not as dramatic as in better kidney function. So I think it's important to keep in mind that we really needed a renal outcome trial that was focused and powered on renal outcomes to answer this question. So with that, the primary aim of CREDENCE was to assess the effects of the SGLT2 inhibitor canagliflozin on clinically important renal outcomes in people with type 2 diabetes and established kidney disease. And I thank you for your time, and it's my pleasure now to introduce Dr. Meg Jardine, who's going to talk about the study design and the CREDENCE population. Meg?
Thanks very much, George. Well, here are my disclosures. The CREDENCE study was conducted by a huge team of investigators and study coordinators, many of whom are with us today, who are led by an academic steering committee. The study was sponsored by Janssen, and scientific and operational oversight provided by George Clinical Sydney and a contract research organisation. We had an independent data monitoring committee who monitored accumulating events, study progress and patient safety, and efficacy and safety outcomes were adjudicated by a team of content experts using pre-specified guidelines. CREDENCE was designed to answer an important renal question. The objective was to see in people with type 2 diabetes, an eGFR of 30 to 90, and substantial albuminuria, who are receiving standard of care, including a maximum tolerated dose of RAS blockade, to assess whether canagliflozin, compared with placebo, reduced the primary composite of end-stage kidney disease, doubling serum creatinine, or renal or cardiovascular death. Secondary objectives included seeing whether canagliflozin reduced cardiovascular death or hospitalisation for heart failure, major cardiovascular events, namely cardiovascular death, myocardial infarction and stroke, hospitalisation for heart failure, the renal endpoint of end-stage kidney disease, doubling serum creatinine or renal death, cardiovascular death, all-cause mortality, and the extended cardiovascular composite that included hospitalizations for heart failure or unstable angina. We wanted to ensure we recruited a population at high risk for kidney disease progression. Participants were aged over 30 with type 2 diabetes and an HbA1c between 6.5 and 12%. They had an eGFR at screening of 30 to 90 and urinary albumin creatinine ratios of 300 to 5,000 milligrams per gram. They're on a stable maximum tolerated label dose of RAS blockade for at least 4 weeks. Key inclusion criteria included non-diabetes related risks for progression of renal disease, dual renin-angiotensin blockade, use of a direct renin inhibitor or mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, a serum potassium of greater than 5.5, cardiovascular events within the previous 12 weeks, or any history of class 4 heart failure, diabetic ketoacidosis, or type 1 diabetes. After a 2-week placebo run-in, our participants were randomised to canagliflozin 100 milligrams daily or matching placebo. They were then seen at weeks 3, 13, and 26, and then every 13 weeks in alternating face-to-face or phone call follow-ups. At every visit, investigators were repeatedly urged to maximise the use of guideline-based care, including glycemic control. Importantly, participants were continued on treatment, regardless of eGFR decline or an eGFR of less than 30, unless they initiated chronic dialysis or received a kidney transplant. The study was analysed using intention-to-treat principles and was of an event-driven duration. With a target at 844 events, the study would have 90% power to detect a 20% relative risk reduction in the primary outcome. Outcomes were analysed using proportional hazard models stratified for screening eGFR, and a sequential hypothesis testing was pre-specified. We calculated numbers needed to treat to prevent one event over 2.5 years. The study pre-specified a hierarchical testing sequence. What this meant was that the first primary outcome was analysed, and only if that was significant did we move to the first secondary outcome, and so forth, such that each outcome was only analysed if the preceding outcome was positive. An interim analysis was planned to occur after 405 primary efficacy events and at least an average of 2 years of exposure. The pre-specified stopping guidance provided to the Independent Data Monitoring Committee was that the primary composite be met with a p-sided p-value of less than 0.01 and that the important clinical endpoint of end-stage kidney disease, renal death or cardiovascular death also be met with a p-sided value of less than 0.025. As well, we asked for a global assessment of benefit and safety. I'll now like to run you through the study timeline and the population recruited. We commenced with the first participant randomised in 2014. In 2016, after we'd recruited 70% of participants, the CANVAS trial reported an excess of lower extremity amputation in participants randomised to canagliflozin. Accordingly, we introduced an amendment to CREDENCE that included a three-pronged approach. Firstly, our investigators delivered routine foot care, including a foot examination at every visit. Secondly, we gave guidance on the care of participants with high-risk foot lesions, which included suspension of study drug. And lastly, all potential participants with a history of amputation or high-risk foot lesions were further excluded from enrolment. We randomised the last participant in 2017, and then in July of 2018, the planned interim analysis, the IDMC made the recommendation to stop the study based on demonstration of efficacy. Accordingly, all our participants were recalled and the study was concluded. Overall, we recruited participants from 34 countries and 690 sites around the world. We screened 12,900 people and randomised 4,401 evenly to the two arms. At the end of the study, we had vital status on all but six, giving vital status follow-up of 99.9%, and 99.1% had completed the study. I'll now go through the demographics of our population. They had a mean age of 63, one-third were female, and they'd had diabetes for an average of 16 years. Most had had hypertension, 15% had a history of heart failure, and half had a history of cardiovascular disease. 5% had a prior history of amputation. Two-thirds of our participants were white and one-fifth were Asian, and we represented all four of the regions we recruited in. I'll now go through the glucose-lowering drugs and the protective medications being used at enrolment into the study. Two-thirds of our participants were receiving insulin, 58% were receiving metformin, and a number of other glucose-lowering drugs were being used. As expected from the study design, 99.9% were receiving RAS blockade. 69% were on a statin, and 60% were on an antithrombotic agent, not surprisingly given the high cardiovascular history of these patients. The patients had an average HbA1c of 8.3% at enrolment and an average BMI of 31.3. The average blood pressure was 140 over 78, with a total cholesterol of 4.7 and an average LDL of 2.5. I'll turn to the renal parameters now. Overall, we had a mean eGFR at enrollment of 56. 40% had an eGFR of greater than 60 and 60% of less, including 27% with an eGFR between 30 and 45. These baseline measures were the average of two measurements, while the inclusion criteria were decided on the single screening measurement, which resulted in some patients lying outside the 30 to 90 range. Our participants had a mean urine albumin-creatinine ratio of 927 milligrams per gram, and 88% had an ACR of greater than 300. I'll now tell you the effects on the intermediate outcomes. Firstly, HbA1c, which fell in patients treated with canagliflozin by the first measure at 3 months. Not surprisingly then, our investigators increased the uptake of other glucose-lowering drugs in the placebo arm, so the difference in HbA1c narrowed over the life of the study and was an average of 0.25%. Canagliflozin reduced systolic blood pressure by an average of 3.3 millimetres of mercury over the study, while body weight fell by 0.8 kilos. Albuminuria, the urinary albumin-creatinine ratio, fell by a mean of 32% over the study, and the difference between the arms was preserved throughout. I'd now like to hand to Professor Vlado Perkovic, the chair of the steering committee, who will present to you the renal and other primary outcomes.
Thanks very much, Meg. So I'm delighted today to be able to tell you about the effects of canagliflozin on the primary outcome and on the main renal outcomes from the CREDENCE trial. These are my disclosures. So firstly, just to define the primary composite outcome, which included four components. The first of these was end-stage kidney disease, which itself was defined as the need for chronic dialysis for at least 30 days, requirement for kidney transplantation, or an eGFR below 15 mL per minute that was sustained for at least 30 days based on central laboratory measurements. The second component was doubling of serum creatinine, defined as the doubling from the baseline average, again, that was sustained for at least 30 days on central labs. The third was renal death, defined as deaths in people who'd reached end-stage kidney disease and died prior to initiating renal replacement therapy, where there was no other cause of death adjudicated. And the fourth was cardiovascular death, defined as death due to MI, stroke, heart failure, and a range of other cardiovascular components, as is typically done and listed on the slide. So, now it's time to move to the primary results of the CREDENCE trial. And I'm just going to orient you for a moment on the y-axis of all the subsequent survival curves you're going to see. We've scaled them all to 25% so that you can directly compare the number of events for each of those outcomes. On the x-axis, we have time and the number of participants at risk at each time point along the bottom, and you can see that the median follow-up was a little over 30 months. So the primary outcome of end-stage kidney disease, doubling of serum creatinine or renal or CV death, occurred in 340 participants in the placebo arm. In the canagliflozin arm, we see the curves start to separate at about 12 months, and we see that the primary outcome occurred in 245 participants. This results in a hazard ratio of 0.70, 95% confidence intervals from 0.59 to 0.82, and a p-value of 0.00001. Let's now look at some of the more renal specific outcomes. And firstly, the renal specific composite of end-stage kidney disease, doubling of serum creatinine or renal death. This occurred in 224 participants in the placebo arm and 153 in the canagliflozin arm, generating a hazard ratio of 0.66, a 34% risk reduction, confidence intervals from 0.53 to 0.81, again clearly excluding unity, and a p-value of less than 0.001. Given this, let's look at the more patient-centered outcome of end-stage kidney disease. This occurred in 165 participants in the placebo arm, 116 participants in the canagliflozin arm, generating a hazard ratio of 0.68 and a p-value of 0.002. So a clear 32% reduction in the risk of end-stage kidney disease with canagliflozin. Finally, we created a post-hoc, even more patient-centered outcome, looking just at people who started dialysis, received a kidney transplant, or suffered a renal death. This occurred in 105 patients in the placebo arm, 78 in the canagliflozin arm, generating a hazard ratio of 0.72, confidence intervals that once again clearly excluded unity. So if we look at the effects of canagliflozin on the broad range of renal outcomes, we see very clear and very consistent benefits, regardless of how we define the renal events, which were highly statistically significant for the majority. Let's now look at the effects on the primary outcome by subgroups at baseline, firstly defined by kidney function. On the top, you can see screening EGFR subgroups, and on the bottom part of the graph, subgroups defined by baseline urine albumin creatinine ratio. On the right-hand slide are the p values for interaction, which test to see whether these subgroups are significantly different from each other. And you can see that none of the p values for interaction were significant, suggesting the results are broadly consistent. And importantly, even in the subgroup with an EGFR at baseline from 30 to 45 mils per minute, in whom the drug is not currently approved in most countries, we see clear evidence of a reduction in the primary composite renal outcome. If we look at other subgroups now defined by gender, by baseline age, by BMI, hemoglobin A1C, and systolic blood pressure, once again, we see very clear, consistent results with non-significant tests for heterogeneity and results that are consistently to the left of unity. The same's true when we look at the demographic subgroups defined by race, by ethnicity, or by region of recruitment. And it's also true when we look at disease history subgroups defined by duration of diabetes above or below the median, absence or presence of a history of cardiovascular disease, of amputation, or of heart failure. Now let's have a look at what happened to EGFR during the CREDENCE study. This time the y-axis on the left looks at the change from baseline on average. You can see at the top that the baseline EGFR in both groups was about 56 mils per minute. Within 3 weeks of being randomised, the EGFR had fallen by an average of 3.17 mils per minute more in the canagliflozin arm compared to the placebo arm, the acute hemodynamic effect of SGLT2 inhibitors, which has now been well described. Subsequent to that, we see a continued fall in the placebo group, but an attenuation of the rate of fall in the canagliflozin group, so that the rates were significantly reduced, the rate of chronic EGFR slope was significantly attenuated by 2.74 mils per minute per year, a 60% reduction in the rate of EGFR slope decline. So to summarise the effects of canagliflozin on the primary and renal outcomes, canagliflozin clearly reduced the risk of the primary composite outcome by 30% with a highly statistically significant p-value, and these results were consistent across a broad range of pre-specified subgroups. Canagliflozin also reduced the risk of the key renal secondary outcome of end-stage kidney disease, doubling of creatinine or renal death, by a third, again highly statistically significant, and we found similar reductions in the risk of component outcomes, including end-stage kidney disease and also the composite of dialysis, transplantation or renal death. Finally, canagliflozin attenuated the slope of chronic EGFR decline by 2.7 mils per minute per year. I'm now going to hand over to my steering committee co-chair, Professor Ken Mahaffey from Stanford, who's going to tell us about the effects on cardiovascular and safety outcomes.
Good morning. It's my pleasure to be able to present the cardiovascular outcomes as well as the safety outcomes in the CREDENCE trial. These are my financial disclosures. Full details can be seen on my Stanford University faculty website. Meg Jardine has already shared with you the baseline demographics of the CREDENCE participants. Just want to remind you that these participants had a high burden of both cardiovascular risk factors as well as established cardiovascular disease. They were treated aggressively with both renal and cardiovascular protective agents, including RAS inhibition, 60 to 70% on statins or antithrombotic therapy, and 40 to 50% of patients on beta blockers or diuretics. I'm going to show you a series of figures of the cardiac outcomes. First is cardiovascular death or hospitalization for heart failure. This occurred in 253 participants in the placebo group, 179 participants in the canagliflozin group, representing a 31% reduction in cardiovascular death or hospitalization for heart failure, with the hazard ratio of 0.69 and the 95% confidence intervals of 0.57 to 0.83, with a significant p-value of less than 0.001. 269 participants in the placebo group, 217 participants in the canagliflozin group had a major cardiovascular event of the composite of cardiovascular death, MI, or stroke. This represented a 20% reduction in this composite outcome, with the 95% confidence interval shown and a p-value of 0.01. Hospitalization for heart failure by itself occurred in 141 participants in the placebo group, 89 participants in the canagliflozin group, representing a nearly 40% reduction in hospitalization for heart failure with a hazard ratio of 0.61, 95% confidence intervals from 0.47 to 0.80, and a p-value less than 0.001. For cardiovascular death, 140 participants in the placebo group compared to 110 participants in the canagliflozin had death from cardiac causes, representing a 22% reduction in cardiovascular death with the 95% confidence intervals as shown, but a p-value that did not reach the pre-specified criteria for statistical significance at p of 0.0502. Meg has already showed you this table of the primary and secondary outcomes in the order of the pre-planned hierarchical testing. I have now included the 95% confidence intervals, the hazard ratios, and the p-values. Vlado shared with you the 30% reduction in the primary composite endpoint of CREDENCE with a p-value of 0.00001. Because this was statistically significant, it is appropriate to continue formal testing of the secondary outcomes. There was a 31% reduction in cardiovascular death or hospitalization for heart failure that was significant, a 20% reduction in cardiovascular death, MI or stroke, that was statistically significant, a nearly 40% reduction in hospitalization for heart failure that was significant. A dedicated renal composite was decreased by 34% that was statistically significant. The p-value for the 22% reduction in cardiovascular death did not meet the pre-specified criteria for significance. Therefore, the results for all-cause mortality with a hazard ratio of 0.83 and the 95% confidence intervals from 0.68 to 1.02 was not formally tested. And the broader composite cardiovascular outcome with a hazard ratio of 0.74 and the 95% confidence intervals shown was also not formally tested and should be considered exploratory. So in summary, canagliflozin resulted in a clinically important and statistically significant reduction in kidney failure and major cardiovascular outcomes. I'd now like to share with you the results of the safety outcomes from the adverse event reporting. an independent, blinded endpoint adjudication committee adjudicated important events, including fractures, pancreatitis, diabetic ketoacidosis, and renal cell carcinomas. We pre-specified other adverse events of interest, including those shown. All adverse events and all serious adverse events were less common with canagliflozin compared with placebo, with the hazard ratios of 0.87 and the 95% confidence intervals as shown. All renal-related adverse events were less common with canagliflozin compared with placebo. Hyperkalemia adverse events were also less common with canagliflozin than with placebo. And there is no statistical difference in acute kidney injury events with canagliflozin compared with placebo. The overall safety profile in CREDENCE for other adverse events of interest was similar to previous studies of canagliflozin. There were more common male and female genital mycotic infections with canagliflozin compared with placebo. There is no significant difference in urinary tract infections or volume depletion related AEs. There was a similar number of overall malignancies, 98 with canagliflozin, 99 with placebo, with relatively small numbers of renal cell carcinomas, breast cancers, bladder cancers, with the hazard ratios and 95% confidence intervals shown. There were only 7 acute pancreatitis events, and there were 12 diabetic ketoacidosis events that were more common with canagliflozin compared with placebo. Because of the inconsistencies in the outcome, the fracture outcomes in the two trials in the CANVAS program, and the excess in amputations with canagliflozin in the overall CANVAS program, I'm going to show you these two adverse events separately. For fractures, 68 participants in the placebo group had a fracture, compared with 67 participants in the canagliflozin group. There was no significant difference in fractures between the two treatment groups, with the hazard ratio and 95% confidence intervals shown. 63 participants in CREDENCE had a lower extremity amputation, and 70 participants in the canagliflozin group had a lower extremity amputation. There was no significant difference in amputations in the two treatment groups, with a hazard ratio of 1.11 and the 95% confidence intervals from 0.79 to 1.56. So in summary, in CREDENCE, there was no difference in the risk that was observed with canagliflozin compared with placebo for fractures or lower extremity amputations. The overall safety profile was otherwise consistent with previous studies of canagliflozin. Thank you very much for your time and attention this morning. And I'll turn the podium over to Dr. David Wheeler, who's going to talk about the implications for clinical practice of the CREDENCE trial. David.
Thank you very much, Ken. So here are my disclosures. So why did we do this trial? You've heard this message several times this morning. We're all looking after an increasing number of patients with diabetes and chronic kidney disease. And here are my facts and figures. 422 million adults are living with diabetes worldwide, and of those, 30 to 40% will develop chronic kidney disease. According to data from the Global Burden of Disease study, the number of deaths from this combination of type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease doubled between 1990 and 2012. The outcomes for these patients are poor despite our current therapies. We took 4,401 of these patients and we randomized them to canagliflozin 100 milligrams or placebo. The patients we recruited into this study are fairly typical of the patients I look after every day, and I'm sure the patients you look after every day. They had a mean HbA1c of 8.3%. They had a blood pressure of 140 over 78. All but five of these patients were on ACEs and ARBs, that's standard of care in this patient population, and 70% were on statins with an LDL of 2.5 millimoles per liter. So these patients are typical of the patients that you and I see, meaning that the results of the CREDENCE study are generalizable. We believe that we delivered a high-quality study, and you can see on this table study metrics for CREDENCE at the top and other recent trials of glucose-lowering therapies below. In CREDENCE, we had the lowest rate of unknown vital status at the end of the study. That is knowing whether the patient is dead or alive. When the study finished, we had this information for all but six patients. Only 0.4% of patients in CREDENCE withdrew consent, and we had 99.1% of patients completing the study. So a high-quality study, we believe, therefore, that the results are reliable. You saw this slide shown by George Bakris at the beginning of this presentation. Just to remind you that the patients already recruited into the SGLT2 inhibitor trials, DECLARE, CANVAS, and EMPA-REG, by and large did not have chronic kidney disease. And those that did have chronic kidney disease were at low risk of progression. Adding now in the CREDENCE study, we of course recruited patients into CREDENCE who only had type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease. So all our patients were diabetic and had CKD. And you'll see here from the KDIGO risk map on the left that our patients are at much higher risk of progressive kidney disease. And this is reflected in our renal replacement therapy events. So prior to CREDENCE, you saw the events from CANVAS and EMPA-REG that have been reported. We had 176 renal replacement therapy events in CREDENCE, so six times more than had been previously reported in the prior trials. Just looking at these data another way, 20% of patients entered into the CANVAS program had an eGFR of less than 60 mils per minute, 26% of patients entering into the EMPA-REG outcome study, and 9% of patients entering into the DECLARE study. And likewise, on the bottom of the graph, 8%, 11%, and 7% of patients recruited into these studies had urinary albumin to creatinine ratios of greater than 300 milligram per millimole. At CREDENCE, 60% of our patients had an eGFR of less than 60 mils per minute, and 88% of our patients had a UACR of over 300 milligram per millimole. CREDENCE was a different population. What did we show? Well, you saw these data. Allocation or randomization to canagliflozin 100 milligram compared to placebo led to a reduction in the progression of kidney disease, however you want to measure it, and reduced the likelihood of these patients developing a variety of cardiovascular events. So here we have, after an 18 to 20 year wait, a new drug that we can use to prevent kidney failure in our patients with type 2 diabetes. Now, we saw the expected side effects of canagliflozin in this patient population, but there were no major safety concerns in the study. Of course, we were looking very clearly for an increased risk of amputation following the CANVAS result, but we did not see this in CREDENCE. Now, of course, these two populations are different. In fact, the CREDENCE patients were at higher risk of amputation, as you can see from the numbers here. And you're going to ask me why these two results are different, and I don't think I can tell you. What I can tell you is that we can treat these patients with type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease with canagliflozin without exposing them to an increased risk of amputation. What does this mean for patients? Well, here are the numbers needed to treat to prevent events. So to prevent one of the components of the composite outcome, we need to treat 22 patients over 2.5 years. To prevent end-stage kidney disease, doubling of serum creatinine, or renal death, the renal composite, 28 patients over 2.5 years. To prevent end-stage kidney disease, 43 patients treated over 2.5 years. We need to treat 46 patients over that period of time to prevent hospitalization for heart failure, and 40 patients to prevent a cardiovascular death, MI, or stroke. Now, we've heard that the benefits of canagliflozin were homogeneous across the various substrata of EGFR. And I would suggest that we as nephrologists are going to be most interested in the patients at the top here with an EGFR of between 30 and 45 mils per minute. That is patients with stage 3B chronic kidney disease. And in this patient group, we only need to treat 16 patients for 2.5 years to prevent a clinical outcome. So, to summarize in one sentence, canagliflozin safely reduced the risk of kidney failure and prevented cardiovascular events in people with type 2 diabetes and chronic kidney disease. This is, in fact, the concluding sentence of the abstract of our paper published online in the New England Journal at 10 o'clock this morning. The slides are available on the George Institute website and on the Stanford University website. That just leaves me to thank the 4,401 patients who consented to take part in the CREDENCE study, Janssen, the sponsor, for having the foresight to support this study, all the individuals who contributed to the various committees that Meg mentioned in her presentation, and, of course, the investigators who recruited these patients at the 690 sites in 34 different countries and whose names appear here. Thank you very much for listening to us.
I want to thank all of the presenters and all of you for listening, and I want to actually celebrate the notion that we can do large, meaningful international trials and get meaningful results for our patients. And please take this back, and hopefully with the understanding and the totality of the information that you've heard here in much longer presentations than are usual, you actually have a fuller understanding not only of the rationale for the studies, the study design, who was enrolled in them, to whom the study results apply, that you can actually go forward. So again, thank you very much.